You have no idea how great it is to be back in South Carolina. Great to be with you all tonight. All of you be here tonight. You know, I hope you love me as much as I love you guys. I've been coming here a long time. When I die, I want to be reborn in Charleston, actually. I like the low country, you know what I mean? Look, I hope, thank you. Please sit down if you have a seat. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm Jill Biden's husband, and I work for Cedric Richmond. And David Mack is taking me to school. Well, look, I know some of the other senators came over. They came up to see me. They're in session right now. And I thank them for making the effort. There's so many people here for me to say thank you, thank you, thank you. So I just spoke to our folks up in New Hampshire, and they did a good job. But I want to tell you, the people of Nevada are watching, and I want to make it clear we praise their diversity as a state, and I'm going to be out there seeing them very soon. Tonight, though, we just heard from the first two of 50 states, two of them, not all the nation, not half the nation, not a quarter of the nation, not 10%, two. Now, where I come from, that's the opening bell, not the closing bell. And the fight to end Donald Trump's presidency is just beginning. Just beginning. Thank you. It is important that Iowa and Nevada have spoken, but look, we need to hear from Nevada and South Carolina and Super Tuesday states and beyond. And look, we're moving into an especially important phase, because up till now, we haven't heard from the most committed constituency of the Democratic Party, the African-American community. And the fastest growing segment of society, the Latino community. I want you all to think of a number, 99.9%. That's the percentage of African-American voters who have not yet had a chance to vote in America. One more number. 99.8. That's the percent of Latino voters who haven't had a chance to vote. So when you hear all these pundits and experts, cable TV talkers, talk about the race, tell them, it ain't over, man. We're just getting started. Our votes count, too. We're not going to let anyone take this election away from you. Look, I've said many times, you can't be the Democratic nominee and you can't win a general election as Democrat unless you have overwhelming support from black and brown voters. It's just really simple. No, it's a natural fact. It's true. It's absolutely true. And folks, you know, all those Democrats who won against incumbents, from Jimmy Carter to a guy named Clinton to a guy named Obama, my good friend, guess what? They had overwhelming African-American support. Without it, nobody's ever won. No, really. And you all know you own my heart. Look, more important, should you not win the Democratic nomination for president, you shouldn't be able to win it without black and brown voters. Too often, your loyalty, your support, your commitment to this party have been taken for granted. I have never once in my career since I got involved as a kid taken it for granted. And I give you my word as a Biden, I never, ever, ever will. Now, if you want to know what any other candidates are going to do in the future, the tendency is to look at the past. Well, I left a law firm when I was a kid with a great job in a fancy law firm that to become a public defender, to fight for the people in the community I used to work in the East Side, because they couldn't afford a lawyer. On the county council, I fought against redlining. In the U.S. Senate, I passed the extension of the Voting Rights Act for two decades, the Violence Against Women Act. And by the way, I had the back of a great president named Barack Obama for 8 years. And by the way, we increased access to capital for African-American entrepreneurs. Let's get something straight. Given a chance, they do just as well as anybody else, and quite frankly, better, and they build neighborhoods. They build all communities. Brock and I were able to reduce the federal population. And speaking HBCUs, I got $70 billion coming to HBCUs. Not a joke. And minority universities. Look, We saved the automobile industry. We passed Obamacare. We stopped insurance companies from discriminating against people with pre-existing conditions. And on top of all of that, we built an economy that Trump is bragging about. This guy squandered his father's fortune. Now he's squandering the economy we gave him. They all think I'm kidding. I'm not. So, Mr. President, instead of talking about impeaching Barack Obama, you should be saying, thank you, President Obama. Thank you, thank you, thank you. But, folks, look, we have so much more to do. I promise you, as your president, you will be partners at shaping the policy that makes sure every single American has an opportunity. The thing that I've never liked, and I was chairman of the Judiciary Committee for years, I don't know what you need best. I listen. You all, the leaders of the black community, know what you need best. We don't listen enough. We take for granted. You know what you need. You know what your families need. And I've never not listened to you. First, we need to defend and build on Obamacare. Trump wants to get rid of it. Even some of the folks in my own outfit in the primary want to take it away. But I'll never let that happen. Folks, I was proud to serve as President Obama's vice president for 8 years. It was the honor of my life. And he'd become a close personal friend. The whole family has been. Matter of fact, our granddaughters and his daughters are best buddies. They went to school together for 12 years in the same small class, well, actually 10 years. But they're still hanging out with one another, even though they go to different schools. Where are you? I'm up in Michigan, I'm up at the University of Michigan. What are you doing there? I came up to see my, you know. Anyway, all I know is I get to pay for the plane ticket. Anyway. But I was never prouder than the day that we passed Obamacare. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to expand that. We're going to eliminate, we're going to get rid of all the executive orders that had curtailed it. We're going to increase funding into research for finding cures. Too many of our families are dealing with cancer, diabetes, yeah. African Americans, maternal health disparities. Look at them. In the United States of America, today, there's an incredible disparity. It's sinful. It's sinful. It's an indictment of the entire system. And by the way, you all know education is a great equalizer. We need to treat it that way. Every child has the same capacity when they're born. Every one of them has the same capacity. Every child deserves a great education, no matter what your zip code or your income level. And I put my money where my mouth is. We're going to triple Title I funding to give our teachers the pay raise they need, make sure every three. By the way, we're losing. We already are 115,000 teachers short. By 2025, you're going to be 250,000 short. And who's going to get shortchanged? The people that you darn right they are. And look, we're going to give every teacher a pay raise. And in addition to that, we're going to continue the criminal justice reform that President Obama and I started. We're going to end all private prisons. And no more jail time for addiction. You go into mandatory treatment. Build more treatment facilities, not prison systems. And make sure marijuana convictions, their entire record is expunged. So when asked by a job application, have you ever been arrested, you'll be able to say legally, no, I have not. Yeah. Folks, let's think about this. There's so much. And by the way, all these states that are out there legalizing marijuana and legalizing medical use of it, we should take a big chunk of those profits and put them into prison reform and treatment. Yeah. Treatment, treatment, treatment. Look, and just as important, we have to be a country of second chances, for God's sake. No, think about it. We all talk about second chances. What do? Someone gets out of prison or gets out of a tough spot, and we say, you're denied all the things that can help you. From returning to your communities, we're going to give you $25 and a bus ticket. You end up under a bridge. We need to eliminate all those barriers to success. We got to make sure all the collateral consequences are eliminated. Look, people coming out of prison, people coming back from serving their time, people coming back out of recovery, they should be able to get Pell Grants, they should be able to get housing, they should be able to get all the things that give them a chance. And while they're there, we should be teaching them skills. It makes no sense. It makes no sense to keep it a penal system. Look, we're a great country, and we have great people. We have the greatest workers in the world, but you should be paid like we're the greatest workers in the world. The background I come from, not dissimilar, except it was, he's in Louisiana, I was in Pennsylvania, in Scranton. We have too many families working their tails off just to make men's meat. Too many people I know did what my dad did, and you know him now, here in South Carolina, who made what I call that longest walk up a short flight of stairs to tell their son or daughters, honey, sorry, we can't live here anymore. Daddy, mommy doesn't have a job. You're going to go home and live with grandpa for a while, but I'm going to make it. We're going to be able to do it. And I'll come back, and I'll make sure when I'm able to get a place, we'll bring you all together again. People having trouble keeping the roofs over their heads. When my dad walked up those stairs, I remember in 2446 North Washington Avenue, I'm doing it in Scranton. I was in third grade. And he looked at me and he said, I promise you it's going to be all right. He believed it was. He believed it. And he was right, because then if you took a shot, you got a chance, you're able to do it. Today, think of all the people who can't look at their kids and say, we're going to be able to do it, because the deck is stacked the way it is today. I mean, it really genuinely is. We have over 50% of all the people who are working class or middle class think their children will never achieve the same standing they had. What a god-awful, just makes me mad. Look, we're going to invest in our families and our communities. We're going to invest in roads and bridges, broadband, water systems, school buildings, rural infrastructure. We're going to invest in Jim Clyburn's 10, 20, 30 plan to get finally to those areas that were been left behind, the bulk of what needs to be done. And by the way, I make no apologies to anybody for it. It's in the interest of everybody. The wealthy, the semi-wealthy, the middle class, the working class, that everybody does better. When they do, everything works for everybody. Everything. We got to make sure black and brown families and businesses have the same shot to accumulate wealth. Look, folks, you live in a black neighborhood, you have the same exact house the guy lives across the highway in a white neighborhood. Same exact house, same condition. Yours is valued at less. You pay more for insurance. How do you get a chance to accumulate wealth? Well, I tell you what, that's not how you're going to fulfill the dreams. I really mean it. You know, we're not going to invest in these tax cuts for the wealthy and corporations. The system's already rigged in their favor. That $1.9 trillion that Trump gave away to the top 2%, we're going to invest in families instead. I really mean it. I've done it. There's no limit to what we can get done in the next 4 years. But first, we have to beat Donald Trump. Folks, I believe her. I said it when those folks came out of those fields carrying those torches. I never thought I'd see it. When those folks came out of those fields in Charlottesville, close your eyes and remember what you saw on television. Coming out of those fields, their veins bulging, screeching hate, carrying Nazi banners, accompanied by the Ku Klux Klan. They heard chanting the same anti-Semitic bile that was chanted in the streets of Germany in the 30s. Literally the exact same. Exact same. That's the day Jill and I knew, and quite frankly, my grandchildren knew. We had no choice but to run. Because this president is breathing hate into these groups. I thought when I was waiting in Wilmington, Delaware, for a black man to come 28 miles from Philadelphia to pick me up in a train to take me 127 miles to Washington, D.C., we'd finally turned a corner. But what I learned is, I'd been deeply involved all my life, but I learned hate doesn't ever go away. It just hides. It just hides. And folks, this president has done nothing but breathe oxygen into that hate and bring them out from under the rocks. At his beloved rallies, he spreads the message of prejudice and division. In the White House, he welcomes the NRA and the gun manufacturers in while our kids are being gunned down on the streets and the corners in our schools. No, really think about how depraved that is right now. Across this nation, he has 35 states suppressing the vote, primarily to keep black folks and brown folks from voting, but keep anybody from voting. Enough is enough is enough. It has to stop. Look, folks, I spent my whole life fighting for civil rights, voting rights, social justice, economic justice, and that's what I'll do when I'm your president. This day, 30 years ago, Nelson Mandela walked out of prison and entered into discussions about apartheid. I had the great honor of meeting him. I had the great honor of being arrested with our UN ambassador on the streets of Soweto trying to get to see him on Robben Island. When he came to the United States, when he came to the White House, to the Senate, I was chairman of the committee, and he walked in, and the most incredible thing I've ever felt in my life, he walked across in that private room with the big table we have in the executive room, and he walked over, and I said, Mr. President, he leaned, I said, thank you. Thank you for trying to come and see me. This is the most Christ-like guy I've ever met. He's an incredible man. Imagine what it would have been had anybody else been come back. He kept everybody expected any other leader would have generated bloodshed, there would have been chaos. But what did he do? He's the example that I think we have to look at. You know, when they asked me, am I going to hold a grudge at with Trump, what he's trying to do to my only living son, to going after me with lies and all the rest? Well, you know, what I said is, it's not about me and my son. That makes me angry. But presidents can't just fight. They got to heal. We got to heal this country. And we have to do it with the same kind of courage and conviction. And by the way, I'm no Nelson Mandela. I'm not making that comparison. But his heart. All you ministers know what I'm talking about. His heart. It's not enough just to fight. We got to heal. And the country so desperately needs it. Folks, that's the kind of courage and conviction we need to end the Trump era and move this nation forward to a more perfect union. I know this is going to be the fight of my life, but as the old song goes, Lord, don't move my mountain. Give me the ability to climb. I can't do it alone. I need your help to climb that mountain. And together we're going to beat Donald Trump so we can chip in and support those who listen to this, chip in and support our campaign. Text Joe 23, excuse me, I got to get this right. Joe 203330. All right, let's get to work. Thank you. May God bless you all and may God protect our troops. Let's go do this. Thank you.